with the trial of the Crusader raid rapidly approaching, it's time to get your raid fully prepared and ready to take on this content. This guide will be outlining and explaining how healers can work together to handle each boss. There are multiple strats, healer comps, and just general differences that can and will be used, so if your group goes for something different than what we do, that's not a reason to get mad. You will also be able to quickly reduce the number of healers in some fights, but in my opinion, it's better to focus on getting no wipes, clears, before worrying about speed. Without further ado, let's jump into the bosses. So with the first phase for Northrend Beasts, the biggest thing to worry about here are the tanks. The melee will be taking some damage from the AoE splash that goes out, but your paladins, priests, and an Arsham chain heals are going to passively heal that back up, so there really isn't a whole lot to worry about there. All your healers should be primarily focused on your tanks, as they're the biggest issue here with the bleed effect. If you have a paladin tank, however, they're able to bubble off the stacks once they hit 3 or so, then they can get back up to 3, and your other tank, if the boss isn't dead at that point, can start taking a couple. This way your main tank is able to get the stacks off of them going into that next phase, but when they do have stacks on both tanks, both will be taking a lot of damage, upwards of 20,000 damage every time it ticks, which is every 2 to 3 seconds. So you're going to need a ton of heals on them, but because your healers aren't really focused on anybody else, you can easily meet these metrics, and you can also use tank cooldowns if you need to here. With phase 2, it's going to feel really chaotic at first, especially when people are getting the debuffs and not bringing them together. Once that starts to happen, this phase becomes a lot more predictable in terms of what you have to worry about. For this, we have our paladins beacon the tanks and then heal other people. This one priest can pre-shield everyone, or at least as many people as possible. We do tend to see melee get targeted a lot more than range for the sprays, so you'd be kind of worried about that. Again, for the druid, they can then pre-hot the same thing as the priest. And then also make sure they're balancing heals on the tanks as well, as they will be taking a good amount of damage. And Arsham, you know, just chain heal, and then maintain Riptide and Nurse Shield on the active tank. For the tips for this phase, prioritize people who get the breath debuffs and those who are furthest away from the opposite debuff, the Burning Bile, so that what removes it. Cooldowns like Raid Sacks, Him, and even Aura Mastery Fire are going to be great to use here after sprays go out. And then also convince melee not to stack during the burrow phase. And once one of the worms is dead, the other one enrages, doing a lot more damage. Because of this, don't worry about raid healing as much. Heal that tank. They will be getting pounded during this time. Use personal tank cooldowns, whether the tank uses theirs, Pain Suppression, or Guardian Spirit at this time. In phase 3, this is the easiest phase, assuming your players can dodge the charge. The big stomp does do heavy damage, so use cooldowns or have people topped off before it comes out. But again, because you have paladins who are splash healing, priests who are going to be shielding people, and resto shaman who's going to be chain healing through people, they really don't have to worry about the melee too much. The range can then be handled by the priests and the druid. Making sure people are spread during the during the breath is going to be really big, so that way people aren't all stacked together getting frozen, and someone can still heal. During the stun, you're going to have plenty of time to get people topped off or add in damage or regen, depending on what your group needs. This fight is one of the longer ones due to the three waves of bosses. So, you know, you get multiple Shadow Fiends, Innervates, Manatides, and other cooldowns like that, especially if your group's taking a bit longer and you don't have that top-end DPS. You don't get long breaks between phases like on Memoron, so definitely take advantage of these cooldowns. This phase is also very cyclical. You know exactly the order things are going to happen. Melee will get knocked back a couple of times, they should get healed back up, then the breath goes out, then the big knockback goes out. I do want to see if our HPAL is able to Frost Aura Mastery, one of the breaths to kind of reduce the damage there, then they can Raid Sack one afterwards, it should be good. Second boss we got is Jaraxxus. This fight's definitely the easiest one in the instance, especially to heal. The only cooldown you're really going to have to look out for is the Burning Flesh debuff. It takes about 80,000 healing to remove, so have all of your healers, maybe just besides one, swap over, and it should honestly go away within a few seconds. On 10-man mode, you get 12 seconds to get rid of it. I think that's a bit shorter on 25-man. You can also use your tank or raid cooldowns during this time to ensure the tank and others don't die while the healers are focused on going to this target. You can also have one of the two healers stay on the tank if you have them having problems with them staying alive, but honestly, we didn't really find this being too much of an issue. Make sure the healers are spread out through the room to ensure complete coverage for those getting hit by the adds or chain lightning. One paladin should be on the main tank, one on the off tank, and then others helping on tanks or the ranged. Again, this fight's pretty simple. There's not really a whole lot to look out for. Just don't get threat on the adds when they spawn in, and don't stand near people for chain lightning. The faction champions fight's really weird to heal. It's not like a traditional fight where you're just constantly healing damage on specific targets. There'll be like no damage going out for a while, whether due to people being CC'd or just them not using their big abilities, and someone out of nowhere will get bursted, particularly by the melee enemies. So you'll make sure you're having people who have quick reaction times to kind of save them. Using cooldowns on them as well is pretty good. But some specific class tips here, you know, using purge or dispels on the hero debuff, on the hero buff on the enemies is really important, as it's gonna save a ton of damage from hitting the raid. The paladin and mage champions will also bubble or block, so be ready with a mass dispel to quickly get them out of that. Druid can cyclone, it's really broken CC that's unremovable, especially once their trinket's gone. It works on 8 seconds on the first application, then 4 seconds, then 2 seconds. For about, you know, 14 seconds, we are taking one of them out of the fight entirely, and they can't do anything about it. and then you can easily go to another person and do the same exact thing. So Cyclone's really good CC for this fight. Paladins get a ton of utility as well. Great Sack, Aura Masteries, Bubble, Bop, and Freedom, they're all great utility abilities. You should be using all of them throughout the fight, potentially even multiple times for the shorter cooldown ones. Then for some general tips, killing the Shaman totems remove a powerful enemy buff, whether it be Tremor, Earthbind, they have a couple other ones. They're really quickly and easily able to be killed. You just quickly auto attack or wand them. You're not going to be constantly healing the entire fight, so you definitely have time to kind of manage these. You want to front load your heals, cooldowns, and mana usage as well, as there are only a few champions left. They don't become stronger. It's not like most traditional bosses where, you know, you get to a later phase, new harder mechanics come out. No, the hardest part of this fight is at the beginning. So in this part, save your CC in Roots, Cyclone, Fear, and Stun for if you find yourself in a bad situation. You know, if you get silenced or Holy Lock, that is something, you can use a Fear. That way you're still contributing to lessening the damage, or if a melee target gets on top of you, CC it and move away. Use your PvP trinket for this fight, but no other PvP gear. It's just not worth the throughput you're going to lose out on, and the added survivability isn't really that much. Like with most real PvP fights, you want to stand at range and don't find yourself near the enemy, as they will silence, CC, or swap to you. This happened to me multiple times on the 10-man attempt. I got my Divine Hymn instantly interrupted, and I also got silenced when I needed to do a Master Spell. So I made a few mistakes on that one. Don't pull on me on that. For the twins, there's two kind of general strats. Honestly, I would prefer the stack strat. It's definitely better than the non-stacking strat, as you have more people together, you're focusing your DPS to be a bit more optimized. And honestly, the damage output, while it's higher on this fight than most of the fights previously listed, if you have a few people who are soaking, it's not going to be a huge deal. Honestly, so some of the tips here, the tank shouldn't be getting hit too bad here. The raid can avoid the heavy damage from vortexes by swapping to the correct color. It's not really healable through on 25 man. On 10 man, it definitely is. You don't have to have people swap if you have really good strong raid heals. Also, you can have your healers help break the shields if your raid damage is low, and Aura Master Shadow, when taking shadow damage, and Raid Sack can take a ton of damage. Honestly, the best time to use these is when your group is, once one of the abilities comes out that makes you swap either to light or shadow, when people are running over, that's a great time to use it, because you're not going to have the people who are absorbing the orbs to kind of absorb that damage for you, so having that when people are taking those constant ticks is going to be huge. For a noob in phase 1, it's mostly just a tank and spank, and those tanks are going to get spanked. You're going to have one main tank and two off tanks. Make sure you have beacons, earth shields, and then major heals going through all of them throughout that fight, particularly when the burrowers are up. They do a ton of damage to those off tanks, especially when they get their debuffs to stack up. And because no raid damage should be going out during this time, just have all your healers focus on the tanks, even Disciplined Priests. There's no reason to pre-shield people during this time. Have them penance, you know, flash heal, greater heal, whatever they got to do into those tanks. Druid, the tank healer build is very optimal for this fight, because even in later phases, you will not be kind of casting heals on everybody. During phase 2, there's not a ton to heal here. Have your healers spread throughout the room to heal anyone taking damage from the bugs or spike cleave. You can also try to save the person if they get caught by the big spike, but they will likely die. In phase 3, this is the part where you would think the healers get the pump, but you actually don't. Because of the leeching effect, if you have people topped off or even above 50% HP, they're going to be taking, or he's going to be healing for 20,000 to 35,000 healing per second. This is just going to delay the fight inevitably and honestly lead to a wipe, because you can't keep doing it forever. You know, during hero times, you might be doing 75,000+ damage a second, but if you're taking away 30% of that damage, and especially after hero ends, you're missing out on a ton of damage there that makes the fight end minutes quicker. So you want to have these full parties passively healed through paladins bombing the tank with Holy Light, which is going to splash the melee targets. Have your shamans use Healing Stream Totem to offer passive heals, and Shadow Priests will cover the last one to two groups, depending on how many people you have that are shamans, Shadow Priests, and paladins. The problem is, with Penetrating Cold, you're going to have to heal certain targets. I would recommend using DBM to auto-assign each healer and mark target. Here's the ones that we're going to try to use. Again, if you have to use different symbols because certain people are marked in your group, you can have it change for that as well. Just have each of your healers given a certain Penetrating Cold target. If one healer is kind of slow or want to have them focus on the tank, you can then have somebody else like a priest kind of focus on both the targets to kind of cover that, so that we only need four healers switching to Penetrating Cold. You're also going to want to use tank cooldowns at this time, like Pain Suppression and Guardian Spirit, as obviously a lot of the heals will be away from the tank and the boss still hits very hard. If you have no way of getting complete healing coverage, have one healer downrank a part of your AoE spell to use every, you know, five globals or so to keep that group alive. With enough attempts, this boss should go down pretty easily, and congratulate yourself. This fight on 25 man heroic is no joke. Let me know if you have any questions. I'll be happy to answer them and to try to help. I'll be also streaming on launch day at, you know, twitch.tv/ebrags. We're trying to go for world first 10 man mode on heroic. Come check us out. Hope to have a good time there and see you guys there. All right, that's all we got for this video. Hope to see you around.